It's a real delight to be with you folks. I have to say I'm so grateful for Southern and how the Lord has been blessing this school and other schools. It's just a privilege to be back with you. I teach at Trinity Evangelical Divinity School, which is in the Chicago area, and we are people who are people of great faith. We are Cub fans, and and our eschatological position has been shifted many times in terms of when the millennium could come and things of that sort. But at any rate, we're just delighted to be here and so thankful for you folks. And it's nice to be with colleagues from other schools as well. So I'll begin, if I may. One early afternoon in 1954, Dr. Carl A. Fitzhenry sauntered through the streets of London towards Hyde Park, famous for the high-octane rhetoric of its soapbox orators at Speaker's Corner. Whereas Billy Graham was a public figure who had preached the gospel of Jesus Christ to some 1,750,000 persons over 12 weeks during the Greater London Crusade of 1954, Henry realized that few English would recognize him as he came ambling into Hyde Park. Henry wanted to listen to verbal crusaders pitch their various ideological wares. After enduring a number of political rants, Henry spied a father and son team of evangelists perched on the top of a lofty stepladder. They were urging passerbys to get right with God. Henry offered an encouraging comment to them, only to have the father say to him, "Do you have a word for your Lord?" The father promptly invited Henry to mount the stepladder. Henry reluctantly climbed up one rung after another. The father introduced him to the people below as an American visitor. Henry looked down at the raucous crowd and said, "Right now, if you will repent and receive Christ as Savior, God will forgive your sins too and give you new life." Feigning to accept Henry's gospel invitation, one man dramatically fell to the ground as if under conviction and cried out, "God be merciful to me, a sinner." Others shouted unpleasantries up at Henry. Somewhat chagrined, Henry descended the ladder, listened to the father and son a little longer, and tried to meld into the anonymity of the crowd, only to overhear two men blurt out, "That blooming American didn't have very much to say at all, did he?" Henry thought to himself, "Billy Graham's calling and mine are very different, and I was willing to leave it that way." If we rely solely on this one anecdote drawn from Dr. Henry's autobiography, Confessions of a Theologian, we might conclude that Carl F. H. Henry viewed the calling of a theologian and the calling of an evangelist as very distinct. This would be a serious mistake for us to make, however. Why so? Our interpretation is specifically countermanded by Dr. Henry's own later words delivered at the World Congress on Evangelism in Berlin, 1966, a congress Dr. Henry chaired for evangelist Dr. Billy Graham. In his opening address, Facing a New Day in Evangelism, Henry highlighted the need for evangelists and theologians, but also for biblically faithful theologian evangelists. He specifically urged the 1,200 Congress delegates from around the world to embrace the vocation of a biblically faithful theologian evangelist. He declared, "In these next years, we must strive hard to become theologian evangelists rather than to remain content just as theologians or just evangelists." He was convinced that any genuine advance of major significance for the evangelical movement would be led by theologian evangelists. The central purpose of this paper is to discern the reasons Dr. Henry, evangelicalism's premier theologian of the second half of the 20th century, came to believe that both theologians and evangelists should strive to become biblically faithful theologian evangelists. First, we will offer examples of Dr. Henry's engagement in evangelistic activities to demonstrate his own commitment to evangelism as a theologian. Second, we will note briefly the ways Dr. Henry related the preaching of the gospel to issues such as the protection of human dignity, the preservation of human rights, and the pursuit of social justice. Third, we will explore Dr. Henry's rationale for urging theologians and evangelists to embrace the vocation of a biblically faithful theologian evangelist. And as a postscript, we will propose that Dr. Henry's life, work, and ministry as a biblically faithful theologian evangelist present us with spiritually uplifting modeling and important reminders of how we should bear witness for Christ in today's world. Before proceeding any further, please permit me to offer a personal tribute to Dr. Henry, the Christian man. I met Dr. Henry and his wife Helga for the first time when I was 9 years old. Dr. Henry was the founding dean of Fuller Theological Seminary in 1947 and served as professor of theology. My father, Charles Woodbridge, had just joined the faculty of Fuller Theological Seminary in 1950. Pasadena, Altadena, California was a splendid place to grow up in the early 1950s. Orange Grove still visibly lined stretches of Route 66 before it entered Pasadena as Colorado Boulevard. One of my first Technicolor memories of Pasadena was attending a large Easter sunrise service at the Rose Bowl. Sometime later, I learned that Dr. Carly Fitch Henry, my father's theologian friend, was the organizer of these services. Only thing I really knew about that before this too much about him was that he used such big words. Dr. Henry's initiative permitted thousands of Southern Californians to gather and celebrate Christ's resurrection. In those days, it did not appear especially unusual that Dr. Henry, a highly trained evangelical theologian, could also be committed to serious evangelistic outreach. Theologian pastors of the 1950s, like Dr. Harold Ockingay of Park Street Church, Boston, and Fuller's president in absentia, also spoke evangelistically and manifested a burden for souls. As a boy, I heard Dr. Ockingay preach in this manner at evangelist Jack Wirtson's Word of Life camp in Scroon Lake, New York. My bias in favor of Dr. Henry was enhanced in part by my experience of growing up as a so-called Fuller brat. I have very fond personal memories of the Henry family and other Fuller families like the Everett Harrisons, the Gleason Archers, the Wilbur Smiths, the Eldon Ladds, and others. These happy memories elicit from me more positive feelings for and a different understanding of the gestalt of community life at Early Fuller than found in certain well-written, coolly clinical histories. This literature sometimes portrays Early Fuller faculty members as independently minded star professors tending to pull in different directions. Undeniably, a divisive side of Early Fuller existed, as a number of faculty members did entertain differing principal perspectives on important theological matters. My father, who in time became a second-degree separationist, participated in some of these controversies. Nonetheless, another evangelistically alive, missionary-minded, and warm collegial side of Early Fuller community life existed. Its merits are often not sufficiently highlighted and celebrated. Along with Dr. Fuller and Dr. Ockingay, Dr. Henry exercised an especially important role in creating Early Fuller's attractive ambiance, ones that he believed was theologically robust, evangelically ecumenical, and evangelistically committed. Dr. Henry's assessment as an observer participant, founding dean, should be added to any serious historical reconstruction of community life and the theology of the school. He indicated that Early Fuller was, and I quote, broadly Calvinistic and stressed the importance of intellectual credentials and theological integrity above practical skills. Dr. Henry noted that faculty members, and this is really amazing because I teach at a divinity school, this is hard to have a whole faculty be behind this, that Early Fuller collectively supported evangelism, and I quote, although a graduate school, Fuller Seminary was unapologetically committed to the importance and necessity of evangelism. The Rose Bowl seemed an excellent setting where to combine academic and evangelistic forces. Dr. Henry also pointed out that, and I'm quoting, the founding faculty was determined to avoid the seminary's theological dilution. On January 31st, 1950, Fuller trustees and faculty members adopted a statement of faith affirming biblical inerrancy and other doctrines as, quote unquote, a sacred trust and a sacred commitment. As for the quality of the students at Early Fuller, Dr. Henry had nothing but praise. No seminary faculty ever faced a student body more eager and dedicated than that group of pioneer seminarians. Many Early Fuller students became leading pastors, missionaries, and educators throughout the world. Students at Early Fuller generally viewed themselves as evangelicals, and they greatly admired Dr. Henry. Trinity Professor Emeritus Dr. David Larson, who graduated from Fuller in 1956, remembered what it was like being at Fuller in those days. He said, in the epochal early days of Fuller Theological Seminary, students began coming from around the globe to join an outstanding faculty in the new venture encouraging the evangelization of the world and the upbuilding of the church, which is Christ's body. We experienced joyful excitement in our school, which upheld the highest view of scriptural reliability and supernatural salvation. Carl F. H. Henry's inspired defense of propositional revelation in the face of dialectical theology's onslaught, his unwavering loyalty to the fundamentals of historic Christianity, his espousal of social conscience and his avoidance of cultural isolation or exaggerated ecclesiastical separatism set the pace. When Dr. Larson's church burned down, including his library, Dr. Henry invited him into his office and said, "David, here's my library. Take the books that you need." Dr. Larson recounted that after a class in which Dr. Henry had given a magnificent lecture on the aspect of philosophy, on an aspect of philosophy of religion, he saw Dr. Henry out in the hallway at Fuller, gently witnessing to the mailman who had just delivered the morning's mail. In a 1988 speech in Washington, D.C., Dr. Henry politely challenged the validity of the thesis that posited that, quote unquote, "in its beginnings, Fuller Seminary was unfortunately fundamentalist in its commitment to a fully trustworthy Bible." Dr. Henry, as founding dean, disagreed with that characterization. Though an inerrantist, he did not view himself as a fundamentalist in the late 1940s. In fact, like Dr. Achengay, he became known as one of the principal architects of the new evangelical movement. In 1948, Fuller had just been founded a year, Henry wrote, "The new evangelicalism voices its plea for a vital presentation of redemptive Christianity which does not obscure its philosophical implications, its social imperatives, its eschatological challenge, its ecumenical opportunity, and its revelational base." My own admittedly impressionistic perception of upbeat personal relations at Early Fuller was based on sustained contact with many of the school's professors. I spent time in their homes, dated their daughters actually, went to Sunday school classes, Fuller parties, and snow camps with their children. I did not sense the faculty members of Early Fuller, whatever idiosyncratic traits a few may have manifested, were especially cranky or socially standoffish. Any viewing of Dr. Edward Carnell's home movies of Dr. Henry, Dr. Fuller, Dr. Smith, and other Early Fuller faculty with their wives at a Christmas party dispels a sense that they were a dour, overly competitive lot. They were genial, kind, and committed to serving Christ faithfully in their respective churches. One way I gained a firsthand appreciation of the camaraderie of Fuller faculty members was to caddy for some of them at the nine-hole Altadena Country Club. Watching individuals play golf often provides genuine insights into character and conviviality. I had ample opportunity to watch the reactions of these men with each other after one of them made an awful shot, missed a short putt, or whiffed the ball. Later, less flattering depictions to the contrary, Dr. Harold Linzel appeared to be a fun-loving and amiable man in real life. It is true that he was not quite ready for the professional golf circuit. A lefty in golf, he was encumbered with quite a wicked hook that took the ball he shot in most unpredictable directions. This circumstance provided ample scares for golfers in adjoining fairways. Mrs. Linzel, a gracious lady, hospitably entertained our church high school group over at her home on a number of occasions. Indeed, Early Fuller hospitality could engender cordial fellowships between members of the Fuller faculty family. For example, the Woodbridges and the Ladds shared Thanksgiving dinners. Sometimes, however, this hospitality did not include special programming for children. I fell asleep underneath the piano in the living room of the great Dr. Elton Ladd during an after-dinner slideshow of the Holy Land. Undoubtedly, Dr. Ladd's commentary was scintillating, but an avalanche of slides induced sleep. As a youngster, I thought the generosity of the famous Bible teacher, Dr. Wilbur Smith, with his inimitable voice, was nothing short of amazing. He won my enduring affection and loyalty by giving me 25 cents for an ice cream cone coming during a faculty retreat up at Mount Hermon, California. Whatever disagreements my father and Dr. Smith may have had regarding competing perceptions of 1930s Northern Presbyterian history, I knew Dr. Smith was a fine man given those 25 cents. My favorable impression of Dr. Smith had been easily purchased, and it remained permanent. Regarding Dr. Henry, I love the fact that he displayed a wry sense of humor and could put on a fantastic magic show. Moreover, his son Paul and I became members of the same class at Wheaton College. As an adult, I was struck by Dr. Henry's urbanity, broad sense of fair play, humanity, personal kindness, and grace. He and his wife Helga, a marvelous missionary-minded writer, became true and caring friends. I found Dr. Henry, along with Dr. Kenneth Conser, to be one of the most godly, humble, and gracious men I ever knew. Plus, he was a man of deep prayer and great faith. He told me that he would sometimes walk into my dad's office at Early Fuller and say, "Charlie, we need to pray for such and such a student." Then the two men would fall to their knees and pray for the student by name. Once, in an almost grandfatherly fashion, Dr. Henry took me aside and indicated he had submitted my father's name to Dr. Ockingay to be the president of Fuller. Dr. Henry correctly surmised that for various reasons, I did not know this, and other things about Early Fuller he shared with me. Dr. Henry also poignantly described to me the grief he and his dear wife Helga experienced when their beloved son Paul became ill and passed away. The faith of Dr. and Mrs. Henry remained unshaken despite their deeply felt loss. So you can see I am really biased towards speaking well of Dr. Carly V. Henry and how wonderful it is that we're celebrating Dr. Henry's 100th birthday. But did this great evangelical theologian actually possess an evangelistic heart? This might seem problematic. Did he not affirm that his calling was very different from the evangelist Billy Graham after he, Henry, unceremoniously climbed down from a lofty perch on a stepladder in Hyde Park in London in 1954? Numerous pieces of evidence reveal that Dr. Henry was thoroughly committed to supporting and engaging in evangelistic outreach. First, Dr. Henry's heart for evangelism was dramatically impacted by his own life-changing conversion experience, accompanied as it was by the immediate evangelistic commission he received to share the good news of the gospel. We remember that a frightened Martin Luther, exposed to a lightning bolt storm, made a promise to St. Anne to enter a monastery if she would protect him. He survived the storm and thereafter entered a monastery. Henry, a tough pagan New York City, Long Island newspaper man before his conversion, underwent his own terrifying lightning bolt experience. Henry recalled that while sitting in a car in 1933, waiting for a storm to pass by, now I'm quoting him, "A fiery bolt of lightning, like a giant flaming arrow, seemed to pin me to the driver's seat, and a mighty roll of thunder unnerved me. When the fire fell, I knew instinctively the great archer had nailed me to my own footsteps. Looking back, it was as if the transcendent tetragrammaton wished me to know that I could not save myself and that heaven's intervention was my only hope." Soon after, Gene Bedford, a University of Pennsylvania alumnus who had witnessed to Henry, invited him to pray the Lord's Prayer. Upon doing so, Henry indicated that he had, quote unquote, inner assurance, hitherto unknown, of sins forgiven, that Jesus was my Savior, that I was on speaking terms with God as my friend. I now knew God to be the King of my life. Had he dispatched me, I would have gone that very day to China or anywhere else in his cause. The very day he came to Christ, he was ready to go to the mission field. Bedford then advised Henry, "If you have good news to share, Carl, don't hoard it with others, from others. Ask God to show you with whom to share it." From the first moments after what he later called his blinding conversion, Carl A. Fitch Henry was all in and never doubted the truthfulness of the Christian faith thereafter. He was willing to share the gospel of Jesus Christ and to go to foreign mission fields if the Lord so bid him. Second, Henry's consistently expressed deep appreciation for the vocation of evangelist. By the late 1930s, the reputation of evangelists and revivalists had fallen on hard times in the United States among Protestant liberal mainline churchmen. They repudiated revivalism, associating it with manipulative, emotion-laced altar calls offered by fire and brimstone evangelists like Billy Sunday. They argued that experiencing Christian education and receiving the ordinances of the Christian churches provided better avenues for persons to become Christians than hitting the sawdust trail. Sinclair Lewis's depiction of a sleazy, hypocritical evangelist in the novel Elmer Gantry, 1927, fed their disdain for the vocation of a revivalist and an evangelist. Henry the theologian, though, was likewise concerned about unsavory practices by some evangelists. Nonetheless, he appreciated the spirit-empowered revivals he'd experienced as a student at Wheaton College and regularly prayed for a national awakening. In 1942, Henry wrote an impressive paper celebrating the ministry of Charles Finney in preparation for a Finney Centennial or celebration. He indicated that Finney was, quote unquote, prominent as a theologian, no less than as a revivalist. Henry acknowledged that Finney's theological views have not all, quote unquote, have not all found general acceptance, except in the small denominations which propagate Finney's theology. Nonetheless, Henry indicated that, listen to this, the revivalism for which Finney stood is the life purpose, this is 1942, the revivalism for which Finney stood is the life purpose of conservatives in every denomination who are warring in prayer for spiritual awakening in the world today. Henry proposed that because Finney had experienced a gripping conversion, he was, quote unquote, equipped for an evangelistic ministry of passion and power. Henry also emphasized the fact that Finney upheld an orthodox view of Scripture such that, quote unquote, Scripture was infallibly secured from all error. He claimed that Finney was one of the greatest evangelists of all time. Third, Henry evidenced the concern for evangelistic outreach by his tireless promotion and support for Easter sunrise services and inner city missions. In 1940, Henry's beloved mother passed away. While mourning her death, Henry reflected upon the significance of Christ's resurrection for believers as described in 1 Corinthians 15. This scriptural reading greatly comforted him. He knew that his mother was now with the Lord, and he wrote, "To minister to the bereaved would no longer be the intimidating, dreaded task it once seemed. It would be a wider opportunity to display the truth of the gospel of grace, even as I had experienced it in my own and my family's time of need. It should then not," continuing the quote, "it should then not have surprised no one that when I was invited, I shared eagerly in the activities of the Soldier Field Easter Sunrise Service Committee in Chicago and later spearheaded the Pasadena Rose Bowl Easter Sunrise Service Committee in California. In 1963, the city of Pasadena formally honored Dr. Henry for, quote unquote, having conceived the idea of the world-famous Pasadena Rose Bowl as a setting to proclaim Christ's resurrection from death, bringing eternal life to all, thereby instituting the annual Rose Bowl sunrise service. Dr. Henry's influence," this is Pasadena people talking, "Dr. Henry's influence has been felt throughout the Southern California community and the world, which is better for his having been among us. As for inner city missions, in 1942, while serving as a Northern Baptist Seminary theology professor, Henry published his first book, A Doorway to Heaven. It consisted of the stories of changed lives like those of Billy Sunday and Mel Trotter. The two men had been converted through the gospel ministry of the Pacific Garden Mission in Chicago. To research this study, Henry, ever the newspaper investigative reporter, dressed up like a bum, so he would understand firsthand what it was like to come off the gritty streets of Chicago and go into a city mission for a warm meal and for a bed, often earned by required attendance at an evangelistic service. Henry's quest for authenticity, however, hit a snag. He wrote about the evangelistic meeting he attended, quote unquote, "With wide sweeping gestures, the song leader that night beat out the hymns as if he were conducting some massive choir. Finally came testimony time. Here and there, someone rose to speak a hesitant word for Jesus until a crescendo of voices took up the witness. I, too, ventured a word of anonymous gratitude that Christ had changed my life since first he became my Savior and Lord. At that, the song leader unwittingly blew my cover." He said, song leader, "Now you know," he said, "why I've been so nervous all evening. That man who just gave his testimony is one of my professors at Northern Baptist Seminary." Henry continued, "It was the first and last prayer meeting out of which I walked as soon as heads were bowed." Harry Ironside, the well-known pastor at Moody Church, wrote a marvelous foreword for Henry's book that captured well Henry's passion for and confidence in the power of the gospel to transform lives. "In a masterly way," said Ironside, "the gifted author has presented a panorama of regeneration, a moving picture of the redeeming value of the blood of Christ and the life-giving energy of the Holy Spirit, manifested in the salvaging of human wreckage and the new creation of utterly lost men and women, transforming drunkards, gamblers, and criminals of all types into devoted servants of God and hard-toiling servants of the Lord of glory, whose delight is to bring others to know him who has wrought so mightily on their behalf. And I've been told that on occasion, Dr. Henry would wander into classes at Fuller just utterly tired. He had been spending the night working in gospel missions downtown. This is a great Carl F. Henry. For me, much of what I'm telling you, I didn't know a lot of this, what we're talking about. Just to have him as a very famous theologian be so evangelistically committed that he would publish his first book on these sorts of things is quite stunning. Fourth, other Christians like Billy Graham recognized that Dr. Henry was committed to evangelistic outreach. Billy Graham tapped him to lead a major conferences such as the World Congress on Evangelism in Berlin in 1966. Henry had met Billy Graham at Wheaton College and appreciated Billy's evangelistic fervor and gifts. Henry was thrilled by the results of Graham's evangelistic efforts in Los Angeles in 1949. He appreciated the quote-unquote dignity and respect Graham brought to evangelism, a healing balm for the wounds inflicted by the blemished practice of Elmer Gantry-style revivalism. For 3 months, Henry devoted himself to preparing Billy Graham's mid-century Rose Bowl appearance in 1950. A crowd of 50,000 people attended this evangelistic outreach in the Rose Bowl, the largest gathering of that sort until that day. Billy Graham deeply appreciated Dr. Henry's commitment to evangelism. In fact, Graham indicated one reason he thought Henry would be an excellent choice to serve as the founding, I have to be careful about using that, the founding editor of Christianity Today, was Henry's commitment to evangelism. In a letter to Nelson Bell, dated June 5, 1955, Graham wrote, and this is quite a commentary on Henry by Dr. Graham, "I do not know any man in evangelical circles with whom I could agree theologically more than Carl Henry. I do not believe that we could find a more dedicated, yielded, spirit-filled, gracious man of God than Carl. I have profound respect for him. He has a great love of evangelism." On August 18, 1955, Dr. Henry, in replying to Graham's queries about the position, wrote about his own commitment to evangelism. Said Henry, "I have no personal reputation for bitterness. My friends have included men in all theological brackets. But in an evangelistic and missionary thrust, I have one uncompromisable zeal, that Christ be known in his total claim upon life." We see then that Dr. Henry is a theologian, was committed to biblically faithful evangelistic outreach. More briefly, the second phase of our talk, how does he relate evangelism to social outreach? In the uneasy conscience of modern fundamentalism, Dr. Henry had magnificently explained the relationship between gospel preaching, our primary task, and social responsibility and engagement. "The evangelical task primarily is the preaching of the gospel," said Henry, "in the interest of individual regeneration by the supernatural grace of God, in such a way that divine redemption can be recognized as the best solution of our problems, individual and social." In his address, Facing a New Day in Evangelism, given at Berlin, 1966, Henry provided specific examples of the way Christ's gospel impacted different arenas of life. He brilliantly and persuasively made the case that Christianity, rather than atheism, is the true font of human rights. This is why studying Henry is so interesting. What he says is so helpful for today. He cited the huge deficits of non-Christian approaches to human rights, says Henry. This is at Berlin. "The clamor for human rights is a hallmark of our times, but atheistic naturalism cannot sustain the case for enduring universal rights. Communist theory suspends all human rights on the sanction of the totalitarian state, thus substituting the absolute state for the sovereign God. But only the divine image as a creation legacy and redemption latency supplies an adequate support for human dignity, endowing man with universal rights even against a totalitarian state." Then Henry sagely related the gospel to the claim that the God of the Bible is the God of justice and justification, said Henry. But the gospel of Jesus Christ does not remind men in a congratulatory way of their personal dignity and worth. It upholds the dignity of man by offering a recovery of his squandered destiny through the forgiveness of sins and a new life. The God of the Bible is the God of justice and justification. The Christian evangelist has a message doubly relevant to the modern scene. He knows that justice is due to all because a just God created mankind in his holy image. And he knows that all men need justification because the holy Creator sees us as rebellious sinners. The gospel is good news, not simply because it reinforces men's lost sense of personal worth and confirms the demand for universal justice on the basis of creation, but also because it offers rebellious men as doomed sinners that justification and redemption without which no man can see God and live. Dr. Henry then gave this stern warning about secularism. It's amazing stuff this man wrote. Lack of vital faith in the supernatural creator and redeemer sooner or later means a terrible loss of human dignity, of social justice, and personal salvation. Outside of the rediscovery of the gospel of grace, there now remains no long-range prospect for the survival of modern civilization, but only a guarantee of utter collapse. In this context, Dr. Henry called upon the delegates at the Berlin Congress to give themselves afresh to a new initiative to fulfill the Great Commission. Dr. Henry declared, "Is it too much for men devoted to Jesus Christ to pledge their hearts and lives to a bold new initiative to give every man on earth in our times the opportunity to accept or reject the Redeemer?" Third segment, final segment of our paper has to do with how did Dr. Henry proposed to these people sitting in front of him to become theologian evangelist. Obviously, Henry knew there sat before him accomplished Christian leaders who viewed themselves solely as theologians, and others viewed themselves solely as evangelists. In his address, he joked that some of the theologians and evangelists did not think the others belonged at the Congress. He indicated that he received letters from evangelists who, quote unquote, wrote that the theologians have no business here, since few of them know how to lead souls to Christ. Others wrote that the evangelists by themselves would quickly derail the Congress into doctrinal confusion. He urged delegates to, this is amazing, he's trying to get these people together. He urged delegates to, quote unquote, accept each other as we are, justified but not glorified, knowing only in part but rejoicing that we know Christ and have the light of his inspired word to correct us. Henry's appeal reinforced the Congress's theme, one race, one gospel, one task. Henry provided a number of reasons to explain his advocacy of the biblically faithful theologian evangelists. First, Henry reminded his audience that all Christians, not just evangelists, are called to engage in evangelistic witness. He wrote, "The question that must haunt the conscience of every evangelical believer is this: in view of the Great Commission, what does the risen Christ expect right now from me and from my church?" I tell you, when I was researching this, I thought, whoa. And I haven't been thinking about some of this myself. But let me repeat that again. In view of the Great Commission, what does the risen Christ expect right now from me and from my church? Second motivation. Henry observed that evangelical advances in the world had been often stymied by the fact that large numbers of evangelical Christians were relegating the task of evangelism to others, specifically to professional evangelists. Many Christians were apparently absolving themselves by claiming that they were neither called nor gifted by the Lord to engage in Christian witness and evangelism. Dr. Henry declared, one major weakness of modern Christianity lies in its abandonment of the heavy burden of evangelism to a small company of professional super salesmen. For the evangelical movement to advance, theologians, as well as everyone else for that matter, need to engage in Christian witness and evangelism. Third explanation, Henry proposed that evangelistic outreach, not nurtured by faithful biblical theology, could end up in doctrinal confusion. Those who came to Christ might not be grounded well in Scripture. I've worked a little bit on the history of revivals, and the question always comes up, why do revivals cease? in some regards? And if you're a Calvinist, you know the answer. But apart from that, what are some of the other explanations? And it turns out, from Henry's point of view, it's that often there was not the accompanying discipleship in helping people to understand the faith. And so from his point of view, that's why the theologian evangelist position was not something that was concocting to be innovative. It was something that was really important to guard the advance of the gospel. So then Dr. Henry was worried about the downsides of not having theologian evangelist. Dr. Henry's perception of German church life may have prompted him to promote the vocation of a biblically faithful theologian evangelist at Berlin in 1966. In a letter dated April 26, 1972, written to the Right Reverend A.J. Dane, Anglican Bishop of Sydney, Australia, Dr. Henry weighed the level of success his efforts had achieved at the 1966 Berlin Conference in urging theologians and evangelists to become biblically faithful theologian evangelists. Billy Graham and others had chosen Reverend Dane to serve as the chairman of the forthcoming 1974 International Congress on World Evangelization. So now Henry's weighing what happened in 66. In his 1972 letter, Dr. Henry cited a German illustration of evangelistic efforts ending in doctrinal confusion owing to the fact that those pursuing evangelistic outreach had lacked sufficient theological and doctrinal understanding. He wrote, "As I look back upon Berlin 1966, the evangelical community has in the intervening years rather forfeited its opportunity for coordinated theological leadership, for evangelical ecumenism, and for a clearly defined social thrust. Out of Germany has come a theology of missions, and that's good. What is not fully appreciated by evangelicals generally is this concern, is the concern rooted in the confessionally oriented churches that sees the defection to Bultmann on the continent was much more prominent in pietistic circles preoccupied with evangelism and a new birth than among confessionally oriented believers interested in theological, philosophical issues as well. Without evangelical precision and involvement at these other levels of a stand vis-a-vis world religions, modern secularity, and shaping theological concepts, I think those who hold that some unified evangelical para-ecumenical movement will arise simply out of evangelistic concern are likely to be disappointed." In other words, if the confessional church has understood what you need to do, the people who are more pietistically oriented, they were the ones who went more rapidly to Bultmann, but this is why you'd have to have the two together. Dr. Henry encouraged Reverend Dane to tackle, among other concerns, the issue of bringing theology and evangelism together in the forthcoming conference, said he. "So an immense task is left to the International Conference if it is going to be concerned at once with truth and grace and with justice as well. In sum, Dr. Henry made a superb case in Berlin to effect that evangelistic outreach to the effect that evangelistic outreach should be shaped by biblically faithful theology for it to have maximum spiritual and social impact upon a particular culture. For him, theologian evangelists were especially well suited to launch significant bold advances for the evangelical movement. Dr. Henry's Berlin appeal about the need for theologian evangelists echoed the very wise counsel James Denny, the Scottish theologian, had expressed years earlier in 1894. Said Denny, "If evangelists were our theologians, or theologians are evangelists, we should be near the ideal. In our world in which we often study theology and practice evangelism as two distinct endeavors, Dr. Henry's plea is one we need to reflect upon perhaps more than ever." Postscript. The inspiring story of Dr. Carl H. Henry's life provides us with a marvelous example of the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ to transform a life. In this instance, a hardened, and he really, I mean, sometimes when people say that a person's a hardened pagan, Henry really was. You know, we sort of make people look like they're hardened. He was a real deal hardened person. In this instance, a hardened pagan newspaper reporter from New York City became a gracious servant of the Lord, willing to dedicate his all, including his genius-like skill sets, to the service of Christ and his kingdom. Reflecting upon Dr. Henry's life can refresh our spirits in many ways, among others, reminding us of biblical principles and practices we too should embrace as we live out our Christian lives. Here are a number of these reminders. Number one, the need for each one of us to engage in bearing faithful witness to Christ. We recall Dr. Henry declared, "The question that must haunt the conscience of every evangelical believer is this: in view of the Great Commission, what does the risen Lord expect right now from me in my local church?" Dr. Henry continued, "Is it too much for men devoted to Christ Jesus to pledge their lives and hearts to a bold new effort to give every man on earth in our times the opportunity to accept or reject the Redeemer?" Reminder number two, the need for each one of us to depend wholly upon the Lord's strength in ministry and not our own. In closing comments of his address, Facing a New Day of Evangelism, Berlin, 1966, Dr. Henry indicated to the delegates, "We shall do little if we do not have the full cooperation of evangelical Christians around the world." But then Dr. Henry added a strong coda to the effect that we will do nothing at all if we depend on our own strength in ministry. Dr. Henry declared, "Let me note in closing, however, that without the Great Commissioner, we can do nothing at all. If we take the Great Commission seriously, we must take the Great Commissioner just as seriously. He that believeth on me, the works that I do, shall he do also. Abide in me, and I in you. As a branch cannot bear fruit of itself, except it abide in the vine, no more can ye, except ye abide in me. Without me, ye can do nothing." It is a tragic when men who profess to serve Christ, in effect, forsake the duty of evangelism. It is equally tragic when disciples who proclaim a devotion to the Great Commission try to go it alone. Reminder three, the need for each of us to remember that it is the gospel, not the gospel plus one more thing, that is the power of God unto salvation, Romans 1:16. Dr. Henry repeatedly indicated that it is the gospel of Jesus Christ by itself, which has the power to transform lives, whether that of a pagan newspaper man like a man from New York City like himself, or a rough-hewn baseball player like Billy Sunday, converted through the Pacific Guard mission, or a brilliant college student atheist like the young Kenneth Conser. Reminder four, the need for us to link evangelistic proclamation to the Bible's authority. In the very first fascicle, which we saw today of Christianity Today, in an article entitled Biblical Authority and Evangelism by Billy Graham. In this piece, Graham explained how his commitment to the total trustworthy character of Holy Scripture affected the impact of his preaching during the famous 1949 Los Angeles Crusade. "During that crusade, I discovered the secret that changed my life. I stopped trying to prove the Bible was true. I had settled in my own mind that it was, and this faith was conveyed to the audience. Over and over again, I found myself saying, 'The Bible says.' I felt as though I were merely a voice through which the Holy Spirit was speaking." Reminder five, the need for each of us to work out the social implications of the gospel in caring for our neighbors and addressing pressing societal issues. In The Uneasy Conscience of Fundamentalism, Dr. Henry wrote beautifully, "The evangelical task primarily is the preaching of the gospel in the interest of individual regeneration by the supernatural grace of God in such a way that divine redemption can be recognized as the best solution of our problems, individual and social." In this light, we can understand better why Dr. Henry so appreciated the ministry of Chuck Colson and served on the board of Prison Fellowship. If Dr. Henry were with us today, what would he say to us? Well, first of all, he wouldn't be on a stepladder. He'd be down here. But my guess is that what he would say, and he would say it with deep Christian warmth and affection, he would give out his valedictory remarks, which he wrote. They're entitled, "If I Had to Do It Again." And this is what he wrote, and they capture so well his belief that we should be biblically faithful theologians and evangelists. This is what Henry wrote. This is amazing stuff, I think. "From the outset of my Christian walk, I have treasured the book that speaks of God, of the God of ultimate beginnings and ends, and illumines all that falls between. An evangelical Christian believes incomparably good news that Christ died in the stead of sinners and arose the third day as living head of the church of the twice born, the people of God, whose mission is mandated by the scripturally given word of God. The term evangelical, whose core is evangel, therefore embraces the best of all good tidings, that on the ground of the substitutionary death of Christ Jesus, God forgives penitent sinners, and he shelters their eternal destiny by the risen Lord, who triumphed over death and over all that would have destroyed him and his cause. That good news, as the Apostle Paul makes clear, is validated and verified by sacred scripture. Those who contrast the authority of Christ with the authority of scripture do so at high risk. Scripture gives us the authentic teachings of Jesus, and Jesus exhorted his apostles to approach scripture as divinely authoritative. There is no confident road into the future for any theological cause that provides a fragmented scriptural authority and in consequence an unstable Christology. Founded by the true and living God, Lord, and armed with the truthfulness of scripture, the church of God is invincible. Whatever I might want to change in this pilgrim life, it would surely not be any of these high and holy commitments.